Good morning.
Good morning.
We gather this day to give thanks to God for the special blessings of the birth of Jesus and to look forward to his second coming. We begin this morning by singing the hymn of invocation. In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord.
Make treasury that is the highway for our God.
Seek the Lord and his strength.
Seek his presence continually.
Remember the wondrous works that he has done.
His miracles and judgments he has heard.
O offspring of Abraham, his servant.
Children of Jacob, his chosen ones.
He is the Lord our God.
His judgments are upon the earth.
He remembers his covenant forever.
The word that he commanded for a thousand generations.
Glory be to the Father and to the Son.
And to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning.
It is now, and will be forever. Amen.
In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord.
Make straight in the desert, and I will be for our God.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the nation of God and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
This is the thanks to you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
You may be seated for the reading of the lesson.
The Old Testament reading for the second Sunday of Advent and the basis of our meditation for today is from Isaiah chapter 11. This shall come forth, there shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, a branch from his root shall bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide disputes by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall tread the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his waist, and the faithful belt of his faithfulness, the belt of his loins. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the young goat. The calf and the lion and the fat calf together, the little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze; their young shall lay down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the cobra, and the weak child shall put his hand in the alder's den. They shall not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. In that day the root of Jesse, who shall stand as a signal for the people, in him shall be the nations inquiring, and his resting place shall be glorious. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you, righteous and having salvation. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord we bless you.
The epistle reading is from Romans chapter 15. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the Scriptures we might have hope. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live with such harmony with one another in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ shall become a servant to the circumcised to show God's truthfulness, in order to confirm the promise given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I shall praise you among the Gentiles and sing to your name. And again it is said, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples extol him. And again Isaiah says, the root shall come, will come of Jesse, even as he has arisen to rule the Gentiles, in him will the Gentiles hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. This too is the will of the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Your eyes sing together the common hallelujah verse in preparation for the reading of the Holy Gospel. Saint Matthew. wilderness of Judea. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, when he said, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Now John wore a garment of camel hair and a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then Jerusalem and all Judah and all the regions about the Jordan were going out to him, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But many saw many Pharisees coming and Sadducees coming for baptism. He said to them, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not presume to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children from Abraham. Even now the axe is laid to the root of the tree. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water of repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand. He will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the barn, but the chaff he will burn in unquenchable fire. This is the gospel of the Lord. We confess our faith in God using the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all the worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us then and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. Crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate, he suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds with the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one Holy Christian and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. And his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide disputes by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his waist, and faithfulness the belt of his loins. This is our text. When we think about that, this text has so many different parts in it. I mean, it starts out talking about one thing, and then it gets into this section, and then later still it gets into the section that probably we all remember because of the word pictures it paints, about animals that usually would be devouring each other laying down. Probably the most noted phrase of that, or the most used phrase of that, is the lion will lie down with the lamb. I mean, I've even seen pictures of this, paintings of this, artist renderings of that happening. And it does kind of give us this feeling of peace and contentment and serenity. In fact, I've seen it sometimes like in nurseries. It does indeed show something about what God is promising us. What this whole advent of Jesus is all about. What God is doing here and what he is bringing here. It shows us the world as it should have been, but wasn't because of man's sin. It showed us a world that is going to be. But there's one thing about this text and one thing about all this imagery that kind of never fits for us. It's in the title of the sermon. The kingdom of peace is here and now. That seems to be a little bit far-fetched, doesn't it? It seems to be a fairy tale. Doesn't seem to be reality. A world of peace? A kingdom of peace? Frankly, does it look peaceful out there? I don't think so. But let's look at this from the very beginning. Let's go back and look at this as, well, the people of Isaiah's day would have looked at it. The Old Testament people, the people who God had claimed as his own, and they kind of had an off again, on again, off again relationship. And unfortunately, this time of Isaiah was an off again relationship. In fact, one of the most shocking things about Isaiah's ministry, and we don't learn it until a little bit later in the book, is that when Isaiah the prophet first comes to town, he walks into town wearing an ox yoke as a beast of burden, as someone who is a slave. He has come to warn the people of Israel about what is coming. Now this chapter is a chapter of promise. It begins out that way. We'll have to unwrap it a little bit so we understand it, because it's not so easy to see at first. It's beautiful poetry, but you have to understand the context of it before you understand how there's going to be bears and lions that eat grass. It begins. There shall come a shoot from the stump of Jesse. Now we know, of course, that that is indeed a prophecy of Jesus' birth. You might want to ask, how is that a prophecy of Jesus' birth? What's that got to do with anything? I mean, we've all probably seen this phenomena. You go out and in your backyard there's a big old tree that's dying. So you cut it down. And you clean it all up. But you don't take the stump out right away. And all of a sudden in the middle of the next summer you walk out and there's this little bitty branch that's sticking out of it with a couple of leaves on it. You got this big stump and a little bitty branch. It looks way out of place. But that's what this is referring to. So how does that verse tell us about Jesus' birth? Well, the line of Jesse is obviously King David. Don't ask me why he goes about it this way. It's poetry. Jesse is David's father. So I guess he was a sheep farmer, because when we first meet David, he's herding sheep. But David was the great king, the monarchy of Israel, that kind of brought Israel almost to its highest peak and zenith. Actually, his son kind of added to the kingdom a little bit, but everybody kind of includes what Solomon did as part of what David did. But the first thing you got to remember about this situation is King David, for as great as he was and for as much as the people of Israel are always referring back to him, King David was not what God intended for his people. It starts one king before. It starts with King Saul. But God intended his people to be ruled by him. You know the Old Testament all, you know the book before that is the Judges, a series of guys who were called out to lead Israel for special situations. But all in all, there were prophets and priests in Israel, and that kind of directed people to God's will. But suddenly Israel looked around and saw, gee, all the other nations around them seem to be doing better and prospering more. And they become kind of dissatisfied with what God is doing. And this was kind of one of those times when they were in between the off again and on again relationship with God. So they were kind of going for him, but they were kind of dissatisfied. And so they basically go to the prophet and tell him, why don't you go talk to God? Because, you know, we'd like to be like all these other nations and have kings. Because they seem to be doing better. And quite frankly, they show up all too often and start beating up on us. So, yeah, we think we want a king. Well, after a while, the prophet comes back and says, well, God says he's going to give you a king, but you're not going to like it very much. You're not going to like it because he's going to take your sons to be soldiers in his army. And he's going to take your daughters to be his servants. So there's a downside to this all. Saul didn't work out that well as king after a while. And David takes over. And he does build up this great kingdom. And his son makes it a little bigger. And unfortunately, there's been infighting that started between the northern kingdoms and the southern kingdoms, and it all falls apart. It falls apart and it's destroyed by other armies. This great kingdom, this great tree of Israel, is torn to shreds. First by the Babylonians and then the Persians, and then Alexander the Great with the Greeks, and finally at the time of Jesus, the Romans. And yet still in the background, we have this promise that this kingdom, this great tree of Israel that has now been totally destroyed, is going to send out a little shoot. People look for this. And they probably didn't sing the hymn or the carol that we know. But the first line of it goes, lo, how a rose there blooming from tender stem hath sprung of Jesse's lineage coming, as prophets long have sung. This was something that was always running around in the back of their minds. this whole idea that God is going to send a root and God, King David's kingdom is going to be reestablished. So he comes, this Jesus. And Isaiah tells us what this Jesus is going to be like. Now, I especially remember this text. Because if you've ever been over to the seminary, or even if you haven't been to the seminary, if you've ever seen a picture of the seminary, you'll see this great big tower, Luther's Tower. In fact, they kind of been looking for something else to take as a picture to represent the seminary, and they can never find it. It's that tower. Well, at the base of that tower, there's this little square chapel called the Chapel of the Apostles. And this text is written in brass letters, basically like a mobile, hanging from the light. And it states, "And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord." That's the essence of Jesus. Now, I'll tell you, that's not an essence that we often understand or identify with. You know, we want Jesus to be the guy that comes and dies on the cross and forgives our sins. But there's this other side of him that is expanding this kingdom of God on earth. In reality, this shoot is more than a shoot. The kingdom begins again, and it's with us today, even though it may not seem like it. He describes all of this so that we know what Jesus is going to do. That he will somehow reestablish this kingdom of David's on a much greater scale. That people who are enslaved to a much greater taskmaster are going to be released and redeemed and cared for. This is that kingdom of God that now is here. It said it in our text, or our gospel text this morning. The kingdom of God is at hand. I mean, John was proclaiming it so that people would understand that they'd better repent because God was here. But the purpose that we are told this is so we realize that we're actually living in that kingdom already. It's not somewhere off there, far, far away. It's not a someday. No, it's not completely here yet. But it's not a someday. God sends Jesus that he might redeem us, buy us back, make us holy again. Make us whole again. And that's a process that even goes on this side of the grave. You are indeed saints this very day. It's not something we'll do someday. And we're told about how Jesus goes about establishing that, how he puts that together. It kind of comes a lot from this last statement of what he's going to be, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. Because the text goes on to tell us, "And his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide disputes by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth." Hey, it says it right there, people. Judgment. It's not what we're really looking for from Jesus, is it? Judgment? My dad always used to say, don't scream for justice, because you just might get it. And this is kind of one of those statements. We look at that and we kind of at first want people to take us for who we are and what we do. But when we get to God, not so much. We really don't want Him to see all that we do or hear all that we say. But it's the righteousness that Jesus brings that changes us. It's a righteousness that's all-encompassing. It takes over your life. It's all His doing. Not that we aren't responsible for to at least look at what we should be doing and try to do what we should be doing and pray that He will empower us to do what He wants us to do. But this is the righteousness of God which, really established the Lutheran Church. Which brought us back to the point that our salvation comes from what God has done. At the same time, there will be judgment. At some point, there will be judgment, and people who reject the scepter of this king, this new king, this sprout of David, they'll pay for it. They'll pay for it. I just told you that we don't do it, but that Jesus does it. But if we actively work against Him, it will be to our damnation. No two ways about it. It says, He shall strike the earth with the rod of His mouth, and with the breath of His lips He shall kill the wicked. Now sometimes we look at all these predictions, and especially when we get to the later, we see all this peace going on, and how does this happen? How does this work? And one of the things that we see differently than people in Isaiah's did, how they saw things, was a lot different. But one of the reasons for that was because when Isaiah prophesies it, he's standing here and he's looking off this direction and he sees two mountain peaks. He sees this king that's going to come, that's the root that comes from the root of Jesse, this stem that comes out of that kingdom. And that's Jesus Christ. In fact, it's Jesus Christ on the cross. That's Him reestablishing that kingdom. And then he sees the other part of it, which is this final justice and the establishment of peace in the kingdom. And he can't really tell one happens first or what the way it goes. The difference in the way we see that is we see it two different ways. We're standing here. Jesus, and on the cross, is here. The establishment of full justice is here. It's a little different from our viewpoint. And unfortunately, when we look at that, that's why we see this as being a little bit of a fairy tale or something that hasn't happened yet that sometime will happen. Someday. That's not the case. The holy times have already come. It says that Jesus is going to be a signal for the people, and that's what we just talked about in His cross. That's that signal for people. That's what the sign that's supposed to draw them together. My goodness, just look around. How many crosses do you see here? How many people, at least in this country, are there that don't understand what that cross stands for? It's been said that sometimes it seems a little ridiculous. The cross, was an instrument of punishment used for people who sinned against the Roman Empire. It was a way of death that the Romans found that was so terrible that people would fear it and fear the justice of Rome. Somebody said it would be like if a modern day religious was established, if they would place an electric chair on the altar. But the thing is that symbol is a symbol of what has been accomplished for us. He has become the resting place of nations. His name and his cross have gone across the earth to symbolize something different. And even some people that don't want to believe exactly as him as the Son of God and dying for their redemption still often study him to seek what he was and what he tried to establish. But for us, it is the center of our whole life because salvation is found nowhere else. Before God, we are condemned unless we come to Christ. There's a lot of things that go on here, but there's just one I want to point out to you a little bit yet. And it causes two different problems for people. One is a pretty common one. The other one is not so common. It's this whole idea of this whole the whole thing that says that, you know, the wolf shall dwell with the lamb and the leopard shall lie down with the young goat. And it goes on and paints wolves and bears and everything dwelling alongside each other. Basically saying that wild beasts are not going to feed on flesh anymore. The way it must have been at the beginning, when this creation was first established. Now the other problem, the first problem that creates is, you can look around and see that isn't true. You can look around and see that isn't true. You don't see bears eating grass. You wouldn't let your kids play over the cobra swole. And so it's like this, it's either a fairy tale or it's way off in the distance. It's a someday thing. It's hard for us to understand that it's here and now. I had a professor at the seminary that said, you got to understand this in a certain way. When it says the kingdom of God is fulfilled, now it is. It's established. It's here. It's just not filled full. It's not complete yet. It's getting there. The other problem it causes is when you realize that this is a metaphor or an allegory. There's a lot of people, and this includes Martin Luther's daughter, that wonder about animals. What is going to be their place in the kingdom? Are they going to be established like they were in the original creation? And if that's so, why is this an allegory? Why is this a metaphor? Why isn't it happening? The simple thing is about, you got to look at the people that heard this. The Israel of that day didn't see the world the way we do. They didn't believe in hell. Not the hell we do. There was heaven where God was. There was the earth, and that was just an extension of the earth. Or the heavens, excuse me. And there was Sheol. And that's where all the dead people went. Good, bad, indifferent, that's where they went. They thought of God's blessings coming to them now while they were alive. And the only thing that was there for them from God's blessings after they died was that they could pass this on to their children. That was it. You got your blessings here, and when it was done, you were done. That's why the whole tale about the valley full of dead bones and the prophecy about what these bones coming to life. So when Isaiah starts telling this prophecy, he has to deal with the people that don't understand eternity or a kingdom of eternity, or the fact that forgiveness goes on forever, or that there's a future for you. So he has to talk about peace in a way that they can see physically what might be, and then understand that it's going to be established that way. It doesn't mean that because it's an allegory or a metaphor that it isn't true. Yes, I do think there will be all the things that he describes here in the kingdom of heaven. This is one of the Greek arguments that my wife and I always have. I always say that all our pets are going to be in heaven because animals don't sin. Now, she claims I'm saying that animals are perfect. No, animals don't sin. They do things that's wrong. They do things that are bad. We all know that. But they don't sin because they're not rebelling against God. We sin because we rebel against God. So the whole idea of this prophecy is it brings us back to an idea of what's going to happen. It transforms our entire world, our entire being. Yes, it's not complete yet. Yes, it's not, as I said before, filled full yet. But it will happen. And that peace and tranquility and a place of safeness will come to us all. It will be perfect in this world. Because you got to remember, and this is one of the things that we always kind of forget. We think we're going to die and we're going to go to heaven. But God always predicts a new heaven and a new earth. A whole creation reestablished. United. Of course, there's going to be that other place. There is going to be a hell. But it's not going to bother us. This kingdom will never be spoiled again. It's not working quite right yet, but it's here today. It's here now. It's here with us. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto eternal life. Amen. We rise and sing together the offertory. Thank you.
stir up the hearts of your faithful people to prepare us for the advent of your Son. We implore you, feed us continually with your word and sacraments as we look forward to his return. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, by the ministry of your holy church, prepare the way for your Son's return in glory. Send forth faithful pastors to proclaim your law and gospel, and grant ears to listen and hearts to receive their words of faith. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you preserve Jesse's faithful line by the incarnation of your Son. Give families and individuals strength to faithfully fulfill their vocations of to love and forgive one another, that we may be trained up in fear of you and love and trust. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, your Son rule over creation with justice and righteousness. Endow these in the authorities that are on earth that they would desire to use their abilities to protect the innocent, punish the wicked, and work for the common welfare. Lord, in your mercy. Compassionate Lord, as we await the day when the wolf will dwell alongside the lamb, and the pain and destruction are no more, grant us patience and comfort and healing according to your will. Listen to our prayers for the sick and the needy, especially for Brandon, Betty, Green, Rick, Sean, June, Casey, and Pam and Stephen, and all those who we lift up before you in our hearts now. Also for the long-term homebound and those in nursing homes, Rick and June, and give wisdom and skill to all medical professionals who care for them. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal Father, you alone make decisions concerning life and death. We now ask you to show mercy to your servant Ruth, whose death seems imminent. If it be your gracious will, restore her and lengthen her earthly life, but if not, keep her in her baptismal grace and in your abiding care. Give her a repentant heart, a firm faith, and a lively hope. Let not fear of death cause her to waver with confidence and trust. At your chosen time, grant her a graceful departure and the joyous entrance into everlasting life with the glorious company of all your saints. Lord, in your mercy. Stir up our hearts, O Lord, to make ready the way of your only begotten Son, who comes to us this day in his true body and blood for the forgiveness of our sins. May all who feast upon him do so in repentance and faith. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, grant that we may be kept in joy and sustained in hope through every trouble and trial in this mortal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. We continue with the liturgy of communion.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
And with all the company of
Son, into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy we receive the salvation accomplished for you by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name of the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us to do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, be all Father, be all glory and honor and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the same night as he was betrayed, took bread. And many blessed. When he broke it and gave thanks, he blessed the end. Said to his disciples, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." After the same manner also he took the cup. And when he given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This is the new testament of my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, and your ascension to heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Take, eat, this is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given unto death for your sins. Take, drink, this is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. The body and blood of our Lord strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the true faith unto everlasting life. Amen.
Thank you.
and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith for all the days of our pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming, be made together with all of your saints, celebrate the marriage of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you in his favor and give you peace.
Oh, yeah.